I will do a quick welcome. So thank you everyone for joining us with this conversation with Troy Townsend. My name's Nathan Simpson. I'm the Senior HEON Officer at the University of Surrey. So that's for the Higher Education Outreach Network. This afternoon is one of the first events within our anti-racism series here at the University of Surrey. And I'm really, really delighted to introduce and welcome Mr. Troy Townsend, Head of Development at Kick It Out. Troy joins us today to discuss racism and discrimination within football, sport and society, and the ways in which it's being tackled. So before we get into the conversation with Troy, I'd like to mention that this session is being recorded. It will be available online after the event. I think it'll be on YouTube. We will have some time at the end for some questions, so do get those ready for us. If you do have any questions, please post them in the chat box. They'll get filtered through to me, and then I'll do my best to deliver those over to Troy. But yeah, good to see you, Troy. Really, really excited to have you today.
Absolute pleasure.
I think the best way for us to probably start this conversation is give us a little bit of an insight into yourself, Troy. Obviously, my background's football, so I've got a good idea of who you are. But for all of our people joining today, it'd be great to hear sort of your background and obviously the background of Kick It Out as well. So it'd be really nice to get a good introduction into what you guys are doing there.
Yeah, I don't want to take up all the time talking about my background, that's for sure. But let me give you a brief insight. Football literally was, you know, becoming a football player was my only dream, you know, to the neglect of my education, which is obviously not very good talking into the university participants. But, you know, I had a dream. That dream was constantly being spoken about by my peers, by my coaches, by people who played with me. And the dream ended as a 16-year-old, you know, as you know, being released twice in a short space of time. Not dealing with it very well, if I want to be totally honest. So all amount of issues arose from there in terms of my mental well-being, which I wasn't great with at the time and didn't really appreciate or understand at the time as well. But the next part of it was that football gave me something to come back to. So I took my coaching badges at a very early age. I think I was still at the latter end of my teenage years and started to coach just because why not? And in that period of time, I kind of, like, young people were listening to me, listening to my voice. You know, I was a youngster myself, but they were listening and they were acting on what I was doing. And it felt good. I think that's the most important thing. It felt good to coach. So I started my own academy in East London because I wanted people, my community, to not have to go through the troubles that I had. You know, I had very minimal family support. I kind of lived the journey by myself, and you know, the football industry is not one you can live by yourself, particularly if you're trying to become a player. So I wanted to support young people who had a talent, who had an ability, but maybe that talent and ability was being questioned through other factors, and I felt I'd done well there. Kept that going for 10-12 years, you know, and produced players and also helped players that were coming out of the system as well. So that was my kind of welcoming back to football, was to also give back. I've 15 years as a PE teacher, so I developed my own sport development company with my business partner. And we were going into schools in East London and surrounding, you know, Waltham Forest and surrounding boroughs, providing physical education. You know, allowing teachers to have PPA time, but also almost becoming a mentoring service without it being a qualified mentoring service as such, as young people who, you know, were being judged academically, you know, the whole connotations around not bright enough, etc., but also excelling in a sporting environment. And we wanted to provide that platform where the two met. So we had a very long time doing that and very successful, I must say. I spent 6 years in a school in Leytonstone permanently, and the levels of sporting ability raised from zero to maximum. And so many great young people, you know, started to see the value and worth of who they were in a sporting context. Very much so that two of my very early young ladies became or have become international team GP athletes, and it's amazing to see their journey, because we created a track at the school and they just didn't stop running. they just got on the track and just didn't stop running, and they haven't stopped running since. So, you know, I'd like to think that we started that journey. I've spent 9 years at Kick It Out. So getting into the organization now, Kick It Out is football's equality and inclusion charity, you know. So we were born in 1993. Our former chair, who's only recently retired 18 months ago, Lord Herman Ouseley, was being contacted by footballers, black footballers, worried that they were continued targeting because of the colour of their skin, without a voice, without a platform to share experiences, and without acknowledgement from the football industry that these acts were actually happening. Anyone that can remember the iconic image of John Barnes back in 1988, back flicking a banana off of a football pitch, you know, at Goodison Park in the Merseyside Derby, will kind of understand where I'm coming from there, but also how far we still have to go. So we were formed in 1993. We changed our name. So we were formed as Let's Kick Racism Out of Football. So the whole focus was around racism. But we changed our name in 1997 to just Kick It Out, with a strap line of tackling racism and discrimination. So it's the first time that we'd received a bit of money. So we got some funding from football, and we decided that racism was a problem and was always going to be a problem. But obviously there were other elements of discrimination that we wanted to provide support for and tackle and hold the football industry to account, to be totally honest. I've been in the organisation now for 9 years. So September, I joined in September 2011. And that's a quite significant time, which I'll delve into in a little bit. But I volunteered to start with. So I ran a business. I left the school that I was in, and the business was still running, but football's always been me. You know, I've been a non-league manager, a non-league coach, call myself a fouled player, but I've seen the highs and lows of the game, and racism has been a theme right across it. You know, I've been impacted as a coach, as a player, as a parent, you know, and as someone that goes to watch. So it's been a theme. I went to an event that Kick It Out hosted in the summer of 2011. I didn't really know much about the organisation. I knew what they stood for, but I didn't really know much about the organisation. And I just felt that there was something there that I could influence. So I volunteered. You know what it's like when you volunteer. You volunteer, the maximum capacity is 3 months. All of a sudden, 8 months later, I'm still there. I'm still volunteering. And it came to a point where I had to make a decision, because 8 months, there was very minimal money involved. It was expenses, etc. And obviously I've got family to keep as well. So I had to make a decision, and I'd approached the CEO at the time and said, look, I can't carry on if there's nothing here for me. No worries. I'll go on and, you know, try and find employment or just go back into my business. And the day I had that conversation and she said, look, we're going to try and find something, we don't want to lose you, was a former England international, Earl Barrett, was also working for us on the mentoring program, ex-Man City, Stoke, Aston Villa, England, like I said, and he was working on a mentoring program, something that I was quite passionate about and something that I started to work with him on. But his dream was always to be a coach, and finally Stoke City offered him the coaching position. And honestly, I think it was a day after I kind of said, well, it's either now or never. And I was quite fortunate. But what I'd say about that is that I'd done the hard graft in that voluntary capacity that they kind of said to me, well, Earl, you know, the day afterwards, congratulations, Earl. And I'm like, hurry up, Earl, I need this job. And I got the role, and I'd like to think that I haven't looked back since. You know, I deliver on education to the academy structure, so 9 to 23, staff and parents. Anyone that knows me will know that I'm a voice on racism. So, yep, you know, an incident's happened. Where's Troy? You know, something else has happened. We need to speak to Troy. I'm not just a talker on racism, but obviously sometimes you get stuck with a kind of a stigma around you. And, you know, I feel I have so much more to offer in terms of conversation around football, but that is the space that people see me. I've created partnerships, I've created, you know, working spaces where we talk about homophobia, we talk about sexism, you know, and I've been part of those conversations. But there's so many other good people now with so many of those experiences that are now part of that journey as well. So as an organization, we're a small team, 15 members of staff that cover right across the football spectrum. So from your grassroots pitches all the way to the boardroom. I always think we punch above our weight. I also think we're the easiest people to attack when incidents happen, but yet the authorities sometimes get away with those conversations. During this period of time, most of the team have been furloughed. So we're struggling the same way that other people are struggling, and you know, football's back now and we're having to try and work out how we work in that period of time. But, you know, I've got to say this, I used to wake up and enjoy waking up working in football because, like I said, most of my work, I run a mentoring program called Raise Your Game and I educate in the game. And, you know, if you can't play the game, the next best thing is to be working in it. But there's periods of time when I think to myself, how far have we come? You know, I've been here 9 years. It was the year that the Anton Ferdinand, John Terry incident happened, Chelsea versus QPR. There's a documentary coming out this Monday, which I would urge everyone to watch to learn about Anton Ferdinand's experiences during that time, how he felt let down, but also bringing it right to this very day. I think football still lets down victims of racial abuse, of discrimination. And it's something that the game has to look in the mirror and ask itself some very important questions. And in asking those questions, there needs to be solutions coming out of those answers, because what is happening at the moment or what has continued to happen is just not acceptable, you know? And like I said, I've been on this journey for 9 years. Social media has grown during that period of time and we see the impact of that. And just this morning, Anton tweeted, that he's now receiving racial abuse again because the documentary is coming out, you know? And it concerns me, it worries me, it hurts me. That's the most important thing. It hurts me every time I have to deal with another player that has been victimized because of the beautiful game, in inverted commas. But I do feel that this period of time is an opportunity for us all to come on a journey and to learn and to appreciate and hopefully be a part of the solutions rather than calling out for solutions all the time. So it's a long-winded way around. There's more to the story, Nathan. We might pull it out in the kind of conversations that we have, but that's kind of a little bit about me and the organization.
Yeah, I mean, Troy, I mean, I've followed you and we've known each other for a little while. And obviously I've followed you on Twitter and social media, and you kind of tapped into that because that is becoming another whole breeding ground in terms of the racism conversation, but racism in itself as well. I think the question that I want to ask you is, from a personal perspective, what was like the turning point in terms of you being fully aware of racism within both football and society as a black man? What was the sort of standout moment for you? Because obviously that's going to have had a massive impact on your decision to get involved with an organisation like Kick It Out.
You know, I spoke about this the other day and I kind of think there was a calling for me to work for this organisation. When I was in primary school, secondary school, my friends come from all different backgrounds, all different areas. You know, they were friends. You know, if you could kick a ball, you were a friend of mine, that's for sure. Do you know what I mean? And if you could be on my team and help me win, you're even better. So I didn't discriminate in that way because Kevin was my English friend. Amjid was my Asian friend, you know, and just without going through my whole friend list, they were just friends. And I didn't see anything different in them, you know, male, female, whatever. I didn't see anything different. I don't want to use the term I didn't see colour, because that would be, I think, a little bit disrespectful. But I would use the term difference. And I realised difference. I played for the district and we were in the National Cup. Anyone that's played for the district, I think it's still running, would know the National Cup. And we got to the quarterfinals and we were heading up to Middlesbrough. Honestly, I felt like I was going to another country. I'd never really been outside of London, and going to Middlesbrough was an absolute trek. But we're up in Middlesbrough. We obviously had to stay over the night before, and we went to a restaurant. It wasn't that plush. It was a food hall in an ice skating rink. And, you know, we'd gone there as a team, and it was a mixed team. It was predominantly a mixed team. I was sitting on a table with a black teammate and a white teammate, two white teammates. But I was the nearest person to kind of anyone that wanted to walk through and get to where they needed to get through. Now, this might be a little bit, you think to yourself, why? But a young kid, he seemed about five. I'm looking at his height more than anything else, 4 or 5, maybe younger. Walked up, stood by our table, and absolutely stared me out. Now, I'm 15. This 3-4-year-old has put me on a spot. I'm looking at him thinking, what's he looking at? He's looking at me like he's never seen anything like me before in his life, and he probably hasn't. And I'm looking back, and it seemed to last forever. I don't think it did last that very long, but it seemed to last forever. His mum came, pulled him away. They went away. We carried on with our discussions. But in a quiet moment, I questioned what he was looking at. And he was looking at the colour of my skin. He was looking at me being different to anything that he'd ever seen before. I'm not classing that as racism. I'm classing that as difference. So he's looked at me, never seen anyone like me before. There I am in the flesh. My mate was kind of obscured by the other two white players. And he judged me. And I was cool with it. Although a 3-year-old, 4-year-old, like putting you under pressure, Troy. I was like, wow. And then a week later, I don't come from a wealthy family. We struggled quite a lot. My father left home very early. My mother was the sole money earner. Remember, I'm 15 and I managed to buy my mum a birthday card. I didn't get pocket money or anything. And I got my mum a birthday card. And that was a big thing. It was a massive thing for me. It was the first time I bought her a card. I am flying home. You know, I'm flying home. I've gone to the shop, got the card, I'm flying home, card's in my pocket. And in that moment of happiness, I'd crossed the main road without realizing what I was doing. I just, boom, car bibbed, frightened me, shook me. The guy got out of the car, took the car out of my hand, ripped it up, threw it on the floor, and basically called me a black C. And it's the real first experience of someone identifying me by the color of my skin and then using derogatory language after it. I froze. I stood there. He zoomed off. I looked at the card. I had all kind of emotions. And the fact that this is so clear in my mind, although I don't want to give away my age here, but it's 40 plus years ago, by the way. And it's clear in my mind now. The emotions were all over the place. And I left the card, went home, went to my bedroom, didn't say a word to my mum. I'm not sure if I even said happy birthday. Didn't come down until dinner time. It had such an impact on me. Then I realized who I was. I'm a black man now, you know, well, a black boy, some would say. And I was conscious of that. There was elements of me asking questions to myself. Am I white underneath? Can I be like some of my friends, some of my teammates? Is black going to be a problem in my life? I asked the questions of myself. I kind of dismissed them as such, because my close circle of friends are the people that made me happy. But then, you know, you play football. So I've experienced a banana on a football pitch. I've experienced the anger that that brought to my team. I've experienced racial abuse on social media. I've experienced language and terminology to describe me that is not acceptable, to describe people in my care. So one of my football teams did, you know, receiving monkey chants from parents of the opposition. They're in my care. I feel...
Troy, you know, can I just jump in quickly and say...
Yeah.
Because I remember that happening on Twitter. You put it up on Twitter and you went through a big thing with the FA with
That's right, yeah.
Can you just tell everyone what year that happened in?
That's fine. That's 2015. 2014, 2015. Just remembering, because it made me retire from coaching.
I remember it happening.
Yeah, yeah. 2015. And like I said, I wasn't a heavy social media user at that time, by the way. I was... trying to look for a little bit of notoriety with people engaging with me. And the incident happened. It hurt, you know, the excuse from the opposition manager, we would never do anything like that. My parents are this, the referee being very dismissive. And that even that afternoon, it played on me so much. I put some, the words were, my team have been racially abused, monkey chants, monkey actions. The accusation that came back, I didn't know any member of the opposition that followed me, and I don't think they did, but they'd obviously looked for something on social media. and they accused my players of having knives and threatening the opposition, threatening their players. My tweet got a retweet from one person, and I remember that person so vividly. Jackie Oakley, the BBC commentator, retweeted it, and then boom, it went like wildfire. I had conversations with the league secretary. Remember, this is 2014-15. I'm a little bit glazed now. You throw me there in terms of the year. I'm sure it's 14. The league secretary asked me to take my tweet down, asked me to not make up accusations like that. He's known the club for years. And I was actually eating my dinner, and I respectfully said to him, "I'm sorry, I'm now going to eat my dinner. I do not wish to talk to you anymore." So we put in our submission. The players had written all, you know, what they'd seen, what they'd witnessed, what they'd heard. The hearing was 4 months later, by the way. So this is another thing about the process of going through being a victim, being in charge of players who have been victimized, looking after parents as well, who obviously are angry. And then the process victimizes you as well. I was up in Liverpool. The hearing date was set. I came all the way back down to Liverpool, from Liverpool to London, sat in a room, and the opposition, the people that victimized us, had not been informed of the hearing date. And so the hearing was cancelled. We're going to keep this conversation civil, so I cannot tell you the words that came out of my mouth during that conversation with the county FA. We came back 2 months later. The opposition were in the room next door. They obviously thought it was a party because there were so many people in that room, and we were in the adjoining room, that were happy, that were boisterous, that were confident. I felt that we did the right thing. I felt that we took them to a point where they had to be accountable for their actions. One of the questions from the, I didn't know you could cross-examine. My players were brilliant, 15 years of age, talking about their experiences, you know, talking about what happened, what they'd heard, and what they understood. Apparently, you could cross-examine. And so the secretary of the opposition questioned my captain and said, "I'm a little bit confused. What sound does a monkey make?" So I said, "Excuse me, sorry, I do not think that's acceptable." The three-person panel said, "It's a perfectly good question. Was it a ooh-ooh or a ooh-ah?" I knew at that stage that we were in trouble. I knew that we were in trouble. Although the club chairman of the opposition walked out, and I cannot use the language he said, but he said that we've lost the case because of the question. That gave me a bit of confidence to think, no way could they allow that to a 15-year-old on a judgment. But one of the panel said, "Well, it's a perfectly good question because I know the opposition and they have a chant of ooh, ah, ooh, ah." We lost the case, and it was at that very day that I said, one, I think I was becoming a target within the coaching circles, but two, enough's enough. Enough's enough. It got me into, I worked for Kick It Out anyway, so it got me into the corridors of the FA. It got me to meet Heather Rabatz. There were news articles, like you said, Nath, you saw it all. It blew up. I thought there was a lot of learning from the FA. I challenged them in a way that they'd never been challenged before. This was personal. This wasn't about my job. This was personal. Effectively, I think they've gone backwards since, if you want me to be totally honest. And
yeah,
there'll be some words that come out from me in that documentary that will tell you that.
Yeah.
And I still hear and see people have the same experience of me 5-6 years on. And that should never happen at all.
It's crazy, Troy, because I think this kind of leads on to my next question, or kind of the next conversation point is, there's a trend or a pattern whereby victims of racism or prejudice or discrimination are almost turned into the aggressor, as in they are perpetrated as the one that is the problem or the one that is causing the issue. I remember very vividly when I was in school and I heard someone use a racist term who I thought was one of my friends, and I challenged him and I said, you can't use that. And he said to me, "Why are you getting so upset and angry about it?" And I said, he said to me, "Oh, you're not even black." And I said to him, "Hang on, I'm mixed race and my dad's black. I'm black, as far as I'm concerned. I'm of black heritage. I stood up, launched a chair across the room because I was so angry. I was fuming, Troy, absolutely fuming. I remember going into the hallway and taking out all my frustrations on a locker, because as a 15, 16 year old kid, I didn't know what other way to deal with it. Now I'm a lot older than 16. I can use my words to try and get through to people. But the worst thing is, in that situation, I looked like the aggressor and I looked like the one that was causing the issues, not the person that made the statement or used that language that they did. Why do you think we are still in a situation now whereby people who are victims of racial abuse, discrimination, are being targeted and sort of made to look like they're the ones causing it? You look at Raheem Sterling. He got racially abused at Chelsea, I think it was last season, the beginning of last season. And the media made him look like the one that he was causing the issues and the problems. What's the issue there?
Now, if you know me, I'm as honest as the day long. And anyone that's watching, when I smiled when you told your story, it's only because it's learned experiences, because we've lived that. And we've also had to do that in terms of our frustration, but then had the narrative thrown at us, you know, the black guy with the chip on his shoulder.
Yeah.
The stereotype has existed and has never been eliminated. And that's why we're still going through this process. You know, every time you speak up and speak out about your experiences, you're then questioned. You're then the one that the focus all of a sudden glows on you, and you have to prove your point. And so the lazy terminology that has existed for far too long around black people and the black experience continues to exist. And we're in 2020. You know, I'm in an industry where I believe I put myself on a platform every single time I talk about someone else's experience, because I've got a voice. So that platform means that I believe that I'm at risk at times of someone saying, is there any chance we can shut him up? Because we've had enough now. Yeah, you know, yeah. This black experience, this, oh, we've had enough. Can we shut him up or get rid of him? And I'm just going to be totally honest here. I don't mince my words. I don't beat about the bush. You know, in football now, there's so many people that do have a problem with young black men who are earning a living in a rewarding industry, by the way, and who are vocal. It judges them. Raheem Sterling, like you said, has been judged. Marcus Rashford. Now, by the way, if you're going to put a young man on a platform at this very time for what he's done outside of the game, okay, it's going to be Marcus Rashford. Everything he's done. I remember there were days when I was teaching and I didn't really understand my pupils. That's what I'm going to say. I thought I did, but I didn't. There was this one day we were going to athletics. It's an all-day event. Everyone's got to bring a packed lunch. This young girl is coming away with me for the first time. So I've told everyone to go and get their packed lunch. She stands right in front of me. I says, what are you doing? Go and get your packed lunch. We're on our way. She stood in front of me. She didn't move. I said, can you go and get your packed lunch? She said, sir, I haven't got packed lunch. I said, what? She said, I haven't got packed lunch. I said, why not? Why have you not? My mum didn't have enough money for bread. Now let that hit home. My mum did not have enough money for bread. So I said, what did you have for breakfast? I haven't had breakfast. The enormity of that hit home like no tomorrow. And so when I see a young Marcus Rashford helping to feed so many lives, and then Sunday before last, see the Daily Mail talk about the purchases he's made and the houses that he's had. Look, I've not come from this, by the way. And anyone that's ever bought a house will know that buying a house is not a 2-minute thing. And he's buying for his future.
Exactly. This is the thing, Troy. He's trying to invest in himself and invest in others. And it
everything that we're told to do. Yeah, everything that we're told to do. You know, invest your money. Don't don't spend it on that. Don't spend it on investments. So what does he do? He spends on investments, but will also put a roof over the heads of so many of his family members. And now that's being used, because it's almost like we always knew that this media loving with Marcus was going to change somewhere along the line. So it's this opinion, you know, the language and terminology used. Raheem Sterling buys something, it's bling. You know, those kind of languages and attitudes. Compare it to a white player. And this, by the way, is not about black and white, but comparing it to the white player that the media do, it's deemed as a positive. You know, he goes and spends money in Poundland or in a shop that you think, ooh, you know, he shouldn't be spending money in there. He does. That's his prerogative, no? He's then judged on it. But then on the other hand, he's then judged on spending too much for accessories in his house. He's judged on flying in a plane. And this is the thing, those tones and those conversations that are held behind closed doors come out in the format because of the press are allowed to do that. And that formulates opinions in other people's minds.
Yeah.
To many, yeah. You know, and we've never really got to the bottom of it. And the media have never had to go on an equality course, have they, to go into their job. They've never had to make sure they understand inclusion to write. Can you write? Yes, there you go. You've got a job. And continue to write in the manner and the way that you have for all these years, despite society having to understand that, you know, we need to appreciate everybody in the world, you know, and I think that's the problem.
Yeah, I think from my perspective, Troy, as well, is it's about openness of culture, understanding other cultures, being open to diversity and differences. I don't know if you've seen it. You probably have. The new Sainsbury's advert.
Yes.
So the new Sainsbury's advert is what I would say, I'm mixed race. My mum's white. My dad's black. We spent many Christmases with my grandparents that are black. And for me, that advert epitomizes all the conversations and the actions of my Christmases that I've had with my black family.
Yeah.
Now, the reactions that have come from that are just completely astounding. And I think it's because people are not in tune or haven't been exposed to black people or people of different cultures, people of different backgrounds. I just find it's so interesting and intriguing how all of those, what I would say, terrible reactions have come out over the last couple of weeks. It's just astounding.
Let me give you a bit about that. I'm never astounded by comments. I'm never. If you've only got to see when players take the knee and let's say Sky Sports tweet it, you've only got to see the comments underneath it. Let me give you an addition to that. Tesco's have made an advert that has been a long way in the running. A black couple were part of the advert as everybody was on this drive of diversity and inclusion and being more representative. They watched it for the first time and realized that their scene had been taken out of the advert with no explanation, no conversation. It's just been taken out. So known to a family member of mine, the discussion was about her hair. We don't think your hair is appropriate to be in the ad. She's got an afro, she's curly, everything. We don't believe. And that's the conversation they had with her. And I haven't got the luxury of hair anymore. So, but many of us will know that opinion of a black person's hair, you know, the curly, the afro, can we touch it?
Yeah.
Is it real?
Yeah, yeah.
Oh, it feels nice, doesn't it? Even down to that and how people would not understand, we don't want you putting your hand in our hair. It's natural. Yeah. It's mine. Yeah. It grows in the same way that everyone else's hair does. It's not a freak of nature. And that's that stereo judgment again that puts us in this kind of box of being an alien, some type of alien.
What's an animal? I mean, for me, Troy, people pat dogs on the head. I've had people come up and touch my hair before. You don't pat a human being's hair. It's demeaning. It's demoralizing. Why on earth would you do that?
I use the term dehumanized quite a lot because of the experiences of our forefathers and mothers during times of slavery. I'm using it more again now. That dehumanized experience, you're taking that away from us, that we are human beings that deserve to be in this space as much as anybody else. And the question that has been asked of me a lot is, what do you see yourself as? What do you mean? What do I say? I'm a black Englishman. Oh, well, yeah, I was born in Hackney. I've spent my whole life in England, in London. My heritage is from Jamaica. Never been back there, by the way. My children are English, born in England. What do you mean? What do I see myself as? You know, if you have a problem with me being a black Englishman or Britishman or whatever you want to call me, well, that's where the issue starts. Almost as if, can black people be born in England? Well, yes, we can. And describe ourselves as English as well.
Yeah. Troy, we're going to move on to the Q&A. I mean, we could sit here and talk all day, but we've had some really great questions coming in. This one's from Seema Salik, and it just goes back to the incident with the birthday card with your mum. And I think this is a really good question, actually. She asked, did your mother come to know about the incident? Did you ever tell her about it? Because I think, and the reason I say this is a great question is I think a lot of children, I definitely did it when I was a kid. I never, ever mentioned any of the incidences that I had to my parents at the time. Only with the Black Lives Matter movement and the George Floyd murder have I really started opening up to my parents. And that's nothing on my parents. It's just the fact that I think a lot of it was kind of deep seated in me and I just left it. But did your mother ever find out about the incident?
I think I have to say, first of all, I had a very difficult childhood. A lot of disconnects. I said to you, my father left very early and my mother was the sole kind of obviously contributor and parent. But we were not close as a family, you know, and I think that's why I had so much joy originally, was to get that card. Listen, she'll always be my mother. And at that period of time, I mean, my mum used to come in at 7 o'clock at night, Monday to Friday, to cook us a meal. Did I take advantage of that? Of course I did. So I was supposed to be obviously at home straight from school, and I'd stay in the youth club until 6:45 just to make sure I was home in time to get changed or whatever. So I loved her and appreciate her in that way. But we were not really open in terms of conversation. So that parent-child conversation was never a thing. Like I said to you, my football journey was my own journey. I always talk about it because in my own children, that's what we've created in terms of, you can't do this journey alone. You need, you know, as much as possible, be open. Let's talk. Let's be honest. I never had that with my parents. So unfortunately, no, she didn't. She didn't know about it. She doesn't know about it. The fact that, I think I said this earlier, the fact that I can recall it so clearly shows the impact and what it's left in me.
Yeah.
And my mum suffers from mental well-being issues now as well, has done for many, many years. So I'm not even sure she would truly understand, you know, particularly I want to take her back to a period of time of the impact on me, you know, and how it's kind of formulated my journey. But yeah, she, you know, now she wouldn't have. So listen, I'd love to have a conversation about Black Lives Matter. I'd love to have a conversation about George Floyd. I'd love to have a conversation about when my parents came over in the 50s and what it was like for them.
Yeah.
You know, and how my mum worked in the NHS and my dad worked on public transport. Two of the biggest things that were taken down in the war and two of the biggest things that they helped to revive. You know, so it's not regret. Life is life, you know, but I wish I did have someone to talk to.
Yeah.
And I've only spoken about those experiences recently.
Yeah. I think especially sort of the younger generation now and younger parents, I think are way more open and understand the idea of, like you said, Troy, you're not in this journey alone. Like, we all work together through it. And I think it's really important that kids are opening up about these sorts of things, because they might not even know that their parents have gone through these things. Yeah. And that they can use them as a soundboard. I think it's really interesting because my grandparents, they don't mention anything. Like, you try and delve deep into the conversations about any racial discrimination that they must have suffered in the 50s and the 60s in the United Kingdom, and you can't get anything out of them. And I don't know whether that's an older generation thing, where they're quite stoic.
I think it's a protection thing as well, yeah. Nathan.
Yeah.
You know, because we would, you know, the love that we had for them and the love that they share with us, we wouldn't want to know that they had to endure pain, heartache, victimization, you know, stereotypes. You know, some of us believe it's only been around in our time. It's only when we do our studying and our history and understand that our great, great, great grandparents had to go through it, you know, and whatever. And then understanding, well, if they had to go through it, then surely, you know, granddad and grandma must have had to, you know. And
yeah,
even I didn't know. And it wasn't till I started to educate myself. That's why how important it is that I realized what my ancestors had to go through. Now, my last name, Townsend, is not a typical English name. Typical Jamaican name, by the way.
Yeah.
You know, so where does it come from? Do you know what would have happened?
I've got the same, Troy. Yeah. Simpson, Scottish slave owner's name. So.
Exactly.
But Troy, I'm going to move on because we've got some questions coming in. So this next one's from Alex Manfredi. Hi, I'm the chairman for the University Football Club. Sadly, in the local Saturday league we play in, albeit rare, there have been incidences of racial abuse. What options do we have in incidences like this?
Absolutely, report it. There was a time when I would have said to you, and because I believe that I'm an honest guy, there's no point, just have to deal with it in the manner that you do. But now I urge everyone to talk up and speak out, as I have done throughout the course of today. So kick it out, have a reporting app. That you can report to, you can report any incident to, doesn't matter if it's the highest level of the game or the lowest level of the game. I'm happy for Nathan, if you want to share my email details and just so that you've got it in your locker, so that you know that there's someone that you can talk to at a period of time when you feel useless. You know, what can we do? I remember that guy from Kick It Out. I've got his email somewhere. Just let us know that what it won't do, it won't stop the pain. It won't stop the anxiety. It won't stop the kind of absolute disgust that it could happen. But what it will do is know that there's people on your side, and, you know, we'll take the process on for you. And so that process obviously would go hopefully as high up as a county FA or the actual FA. So that's kind of what we can do for you. And almost, listen, we can't get a desired outcome, but put you at ease that we're there batting for you. And I think as I grew up, I never felt that there was anyone in my corner. So actually, we just dealt with racism, I'm going to say it here, on the football pitch. That's how we dealt with it. Some of it positive in your actions, in the way that you play. Some of it, not so positive. But it was the way that we felt we had to deal with things, because we didn't feel telling anyone. Remember, there's a referee on the pitch at every stage, would benefit. But yeah, you know, anything that happens, or it doesn't matter whether it's rare or not, doesn't matter if you think, it's silly, we don't want to, you know, if there's anything that happens on a football pitch in regards to discrimination, get in contact with us, let us know, let us support you through a process.
Great. This next one's from Claire Goddard. Hello, Troy. Great to listen to you today. You mentioned that you deal with homophobia as part of your campaign. I think only one male professional footballer has ever come out as gay, Justin Flashanu, who tragically ended up taking his own life. There are several female professional footballers who have come out, including the best female player in the world, Megan Rapinoe. That's an incredibly positive example for all young women coming into the game. Why do you think that differences exist between men's and women's football from that perspective?
It's a great question. Let's talk about men being macho. Let's talk about men never showing or never allowed to show signs of weakness. Let's talk about the language and terminology that has been used that I can't use on this platform, but has been used to talk to players, to shout at players. And a lot of that would be homophobic. Let's talk about the fact that if you show that you're different, and that could be in many different ways, by the way, many ways that you get ostracized, you get isolated, you know. So we talk about, I talk very much to young players about trying to be you, trying to be who you are. Many players say to me, oh, we're different in the football environment than we are if we're outside the football environment. I'm not aware that there's gay male players. There's, you know, no one's identified it to me, but I do believe that they are. There was a lad, to be honest, that was sat in one of my sessions and had been on loan up in Scotland and said that his teammate came out to the changing room. And he said it was an unbelievable experience of togetherness, of happiness, of we're so glad you've done this, you know, and we're here to support you. But then on the other side, it's the reaction, it's the fans, it's the conversations behind closed doors that we don't know. Gareth Thomas, the rugby player, had the pleasure of him sitting in one of my sessions around homophobia. And when we were talking afterwards, he said to me, he came out to, obviously he's a rugby player, he came out to his team. And most of the conversations, and in being in football, I know this, happen in the treatment room. So most of the conversations happen in the treatment room. I don't know, that seems like a safe space to have conversations for some reason. He was getting some strapping behind the door. Players have come in. So they push the door. They can't see him. They're having a conversation with the physio. It's demeaning conversation. It shows their personal ignorance. It's supposed to be banter. Gareth pushes the door and says, I'm here, chaps. And the look on their faces, he said to me, obviously I didn't see their face, but he said, Troy, they were stunned. They were embarrassed, but it took them on a journey with him. So out of a negative became a positive. I'm not sure the male game is absolutely that welcoming at the moment. And I don't think there's enough in place for the male game to be that welcoming. There was a time I did a talk 5 years ago for the Proud Lilywhites, who's Tottenham's LGBT fan group. And the last question they asked me was, so when are we going to see a gay player in the Premier League? And it was a real positive evening. And I put the dampeners on it because I said, not in my lifetime. And there was uproar. How can you say that? What's it? And you know what? At that time, you either stand by your convictions or you break. And I stood by my convictions because I said football is not ready to embrace difference. The male game. 5 years on, very, very good friends of mine. Troy, do you remember that day? And I said, I remember that day. What I'm saying is I hope for change. I'm not optimistic of change. There are issues in the female game. Yes, it is more welcoming, but having some good friends that work in that space say to me, Troy, don't think it's all, there are the same issues in the female. There's the same judgment. They're the same perception. So whilst it is more common, there is still an element of that judgment and perception that exists. There's a lot of great work. I must say this, there's a lot of great work going on in this space, particularly from fan groups, you know, the Pride in Football fan group, who are the kind of the umbrella of all the fan groups. We run an initiative called Fans for Diversity, and the LGBTQ community have absolutely embraced that, you know, because they want everyone to feel comfortable and confident to go and support their football team without fear, just like I would as a black man want to feel comfortable and confident to support my football team without fear of. And unfortunately, that fear still exists.
Yeah, I think it's going to, like you said, there's so many different facets in terms of that comes under the umbrella of discrimination, and it's going to take a heck of a long time. And people have to remember that when you make comments like that, Troy, it's not to put the dampener on things. It's realistic. Like at the end of the day, probably we're never going to see an end to some forms of discrimination, but we can initiate change by taking positive action.
All I would say, Nate, is that I think that I would have thought, and having worked in this space for 9 years in this space, and obviously for many years in another space, that we would have been further down the line.
Yeah.
For 2020, I would have thought we would have been further down the line in all aspects.
I'm going to put two more questions to you, Troy, but this one kind of links in quite nicely. So this one's from Lauren Regan. You spoke about how hard it is sometimes to keep going due to not seeing much change over the years. So how do you keep yourself motivated when you're feeling like this?
I've got to say to you now, that is the toughest question out of the lot.
That's why I wanted to get it in.
Yeah, it actually comes across as quite easy. Honestly, Lauren, I don't know. I've got to be honest with you.
Are you able to take yourself into a different headspace, Troy? Like,
No, you can't.
Was it football constant?
Football doesn't allow that.
It's constant.
Football does not allow you to switch off. Mm-hmm. If you switch off, you miss something. And then people question, where were you? So your weekends. Yes, I can sit down. My son is a professional footballer. It's the probably 90 minutes of a time that I actually do switch off.
Yeah.
I remember I was supposed to be having a weekend off. Palace were playing at home. Someone else was on call as such. So we have, you know, on call, any incident. I get a WhatsApp. Haringey Borough have walked off the football pitch against Yeovil. Racial abuse. This was a week after England got racially abused in Bulgaria last year. It comes through. I'm off. But you can't leave that alone, can you? So I send a message out back into the team. I'm dealing with a couple of media requests. It's just before 3 o'clock. And I'm thinking to myself, I cannot detach myself. One, I know the Haringey manager. I wonder what he's gone through. I know a few of the players. If you're in this game, in answer to the question, you're either invested in it or you're not. They're, you know, and in the space that we're in, because football happens all day Saturday, all day Sunday, midweek, evenings, you can't switch off. So I don't do very well in finding that space of detachment. Mm. I'm at birthday parties and I'm checking my phone. I'm at my grandchildren's and I'm checking. I've just got to take this call. I'm sorry. If you do, you're going to miss something, and then the game moves so fast, you know. And like I said, because I'm one of the people that almost a designated person for the media to talk to, they're no respecter of your personal time, your personal space. What I've done during lockdown is. I don't even think this is anything, but I don't answer a call before 10 o'clock. I don't, unless it's something absolutely nailed on important. So what I've started doing lately is keep my phone off now, because normally I'd look at it and think, oh, okay. My work, I've got a session after this, so my work could finish at 6 and 7. I struggle with my mental well-being, so sometimes I prefer to be more active than less active, because then, particularly during this period of time, it means my mind cannot run away with me. To answer that question, I don't do it very well at all. And because of the game, and because of my status in the game, you can't switch off.
Yeah, it's tough. Troy, we've got one more question, and I want to put That's this fine. One to you because I think fine. It's a really, yeah. really good one. Unfortunately, it's anonymous. The question is, how much action and change is realistic to expect until we have greater diversity amongst the top decision makers in football? This is a top question. This is one I wanted to ask you, actually.
If Lauren doesn't mind, I'm going to move her question down to the second best question. And this is the best question. If she doesn't mind, I'm happy to put it equal. we ain't going to say this. It's not going to happen. If you don't have... When you look at the representation on the football, let's strip it back a bit. You look at representation on the playing side of the game. There's no concerns there, are there? You know, we see black, well, there are. We don't see enough Asian players. But we see black players. We see what football classes as minority ethnic players. We're flooded. Apparently 1/3 is black players. I don't think they've got the official stats. The problems start when black players want to transition from playing, because their time's up, into other areas of the industry. So we look at black managers. We've got 5. We normally go up to 7, 8, and then go down to 1, 2. We've got 5 out of 92. We've got 1 board member, director of football in Sir Les Ferdinand at Queen's Park Rangers. We have 1 chairman in Ben Robinson at Burton Albion. Out of 92 football clubs, the boards on the Premier League, the FA, the PFA, the EFL, the LMA lack representation from black males, from black females, Asian females, Asian males, from women. Lack representation. So middle class white and stale remains and has remained for ever a day. When they do accept, it's almost like we'll get one through in the door, close the door back down again. We, you know, there's our diversity going up. This is why I have so much of an issue with the terminology BAME, because in football, it's all about influencing their percentage rather than talking about me as a black person wanting to get an opportunity in football and wanting to understand the Asian experience. And I'm not quite sure what minority ethnic means. The FA's description is everything other than white. For me, everything other than white means that that white privilege is the seniority and everything else filters down. It's a question. So the anonymous person, it's a question that I have posed over and over and over again. I'm actually not the one to answer it, to be honest, because I'm fed up of having to answer it in a different way, not in this circle, but in a different way. The question needs to be asked to the hirers and firers within the boardrooms, to the people that manage the game. There is I don't know if you're aware, there's the FA launched a diversity code last month that is looking at representation amongst all the football clubs, looking at the demographics, looking at, you know, ways to do things. It's voluntary. Everything around the experience of black people, Asian people, women seems to be voluntary. But apparently they will hold clubs and to account. Whilst that's in place, the Premier League don't acknowledge it. So it won't be a working practice in the Premier League. They'll say it's a great thing to do. They won't acknowledge it. The FA, I'm not sure they're acknowledging it, although it's their code. The EFL haven't said they're acknowledging it. So basically what I'm saying is, in this industry, it's do as I say, not as I do.
Mm.
And that is the issue for so many, because particularly from a coaching circle, we're going to lose another generation of absolutely top coaches who feel that the game is not for them, who feel that the opportunities are being denied. From experience, by the way. I'm not just saying that.
Troy,
from
experience. I'm one of them.
There you go. There you go. And I'm talking about Ricky Hill, the former Luton Town and England midfielder, presented the Rooney Rule 30 years ago because he had an experience of playing in America and said to the English FA, this is a way of dealing with underrepresentation.
Mm.
30 years down the line, we're talking about the Rooney Rule still, and we're not even implementing it properly.
Yeah.
So the question is absolutely spot on. I don't actually visibly see real change until the influence upstairs starts to be more representative of the playing circles, the playing industry, and you can see people transitioning from football boots into shirt and ties and suits and dresses, and so that, you know, anybody feels that they can transition and use their influence of working in the game to then help the game move forward and become more representative in years to come than what it is at this various stage. And I'm talking about the male game. I'm talking about the women's game as well. You know, I feel about the women's game is no one wants to criticize it too much at the moment because it's on the up. Mm. And when something's on the up, you don't want to criticize. You know, you don't want anything negative to be rolled around a women's game. But there's lack of representation in the women's game from the playing side of it, from the officiating side of it, from the boardroom side of it. You know, there's lack of opportunity for women to manage, you know, in that circle. How many male managers are in that circle? Why can't women transfer and work in the men's game, you know, in terms of coaching positions and stuff like that?
Yeah,
they can in academies, but normally they're looking after the foundation phase boys, 9 to 12s. Mm. Why? Because they're not able to handle the 13s upwards. You know, so there's so much disparity in the game. I would like a top to bottom root approach where we judge the game. It questions itself. It asks the most hardest of questions. And then actions and implementations are put in place to help support that change. This diversity code apparently is one step to doing that. I think the first judgment will come at the end of the season when clubs have to, you know, submit their kind of actions and data for us all to read, because football's not very good at sharing data as well.
I think that you're completely right, Troy. From my perspective, having worked in and out of the FA and in football for the last 10 years before making the transition over to the University of Surrey, I think it's the game is run by numbers. And in particularly when it comes to getting, and I will say this, getting ethnic minorities in through the door. And that's how I've seen it personally when I've gone to interviews, when I've gone to coaching clubs. Sometimes I do feel like I've been brought in to tick a box.
Yeah.
And football needs to understand that we need to understand different cultures. We need to understand the workings of people. We need to understand how they operate, not just to get tick boxes and data. For me, people, we read that. We can understand it. We're not stupid. We can see that what's going on.
Nathan, if you don't mind, and I know that people will want to be jumping off now, in a nutshell, and the way football is run, listen, we've all got to remember, Greg Clark recently lost his job as the FA chairman, which should be the most powerfulest person in football in England. I don't think it is. I always think the Premier League is more powerful, but it should be the most powerful position. He was also vice president of FIFA. He lost his position because in one swoop, he took a bowling ball and knocked out so many different people from different backgrounds, from black players. Anyone that doesn't know that coloured is not the correct terminology and works in football, then I'm sorry, how have you been in your role for so long? Yeah. Anyone that questions why Asian people over black people want to work in the FA's IT department, anyone that says or recalls stories of girls not wanting the ball kicked at them too hard because it's scared, and anyone that says that being gay is a life choice, we have a fundamental problem. My issue with that is that it cannot just be Greg Clark.
Yeah.
It cannot just be Greg Clark, but it seems like he's the one, because of his lazy terminology, that has taken the hit for it.
Yeah, I completely agree. If there's someone at the top, there's always going to be someone parallel that's making the same comments and things like that. So,
yeah.
Troy, I want to say thank you so, so much. I think just looking at the chat box, everyone's saying that we could sit and have another hour or two listening to you. As always, it's an absolute pleasure and it's really great to catch up with you. Just want to say on behalf of University of Surrey, thank you so much for getting involved.
Absolutely.
It'd be great to have you involved in something again in the future. I'll be tapping you up. I won't call you before 10 o'clock.
Nathan, anyone that didn't get a question answered, and if you want to relay those questions for me, then I'm happy to do some video responses so that they feel that they participate and had their questions answered as well. So if you want to collate those and send them over to me, then I'll respond to those as well.
Perfect. All right, Troy. Take care of yourself. Try and get a bit of you time.
We'll definitely do. We'll definitely try to, that's for sure.
Lovely. All right, Troy. I'll see you soon. See you later.
Thank you to everyone for listening.
Thank you. Thanks, everyone. Thank you. Bye.
Bye-bye.